Hi there. Thank you for your faithfulness to Vepaturash Television through your wonderful English TV show, Levi's Talk. Today is another day. That means new things have started. Reason why we have received for you in our section on gospel, Prophet Schilo Franklinel from Phila Church, the church which is led by Pastor Atoms Mbuma that I greet. And with him, ladies and gentlemen, we discussed the topic about prayer. You know, you have a topic for which you have been praying for ages, but still not getting the answer. Maybe, ladies and gentlemen, you are to blame. So let's watch this talk between Prophet Schilo and your humble servant, Levi, and discover what we said about prayer. Today in our section on gospel, we have a privilege to receive for you Prophet Schilo Franklinel, who is also the leader of Prophetic 101. Apart from that, he's an entrepreneur and a productivity coach and consultant, to whom I say hello.
Hello.
Thank you and welcome to Levi's Talk.
Thank you so much.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, today with Prophet Schilo, we're going to discuss a very good topic, that is prayer. So you have many questions about prayer, but today I think you're going to learn something from this God servant. Now, the first question is, what is a prayer?
I think for me, prayer is a kind of exchange, you see. First of all, prayer is not a religious act. It's a spiritual act. And most of the time when people are coming to pray, they're coming to wait just to get something, but not to exchange, not to commune, not to fellowship, you see. So prayer is also a law action. In other words, it's like you're going to a court and you ask to the judge to respond, to judge fairly your problem or your issue. So prayer is actually, this is the way I define prayer, is allowing God to come and intervene on earthly problem.
Yes, but why should we pray? Because we can wake up in the morning and God does everything for us. There is a predestination, there is a destiny, and we don't have to pray. I don't know why should we pray.
When you read in the Bible, you will see that Moses is speaking about something. He says that every day God used to come and fellowship with Adam. In other words, God wants a relationship, a good relationship with man. So prayer is, you know, there's no relationship without communication. So prayer is the way we communicate with God. So that's why we should pray, not because God will answer first, but because we communicate. So it's help us to communicate with God and, you know, grow our relationship and fellowship with him.
Yes, meaning praying is communicating with God. Mm-hmm. But how should we communicate with God?
First of all, it's by faith. Mm-hmm. Because faith is, you know, it's like a currency in the spiritual realm. Through faith, we have everything. So we cannot come to God without believing it exists, that the Bible says. But secondly, after faith, we should speak to him. You know, communication is the way we speak and somebody also respond, you see. So we have to speak, and most of the time people just speak without hearing. So it's that exchange in communication that is very important, speaking to God. That's what I mean by communication.
Okay, now is there an appropriate position for praying? Or there is a specific position that you have to use when you're praying so that you may be responded by God?
In the New Covenants, there's no specific, even not a specific place. You see, the Bible says that in John chapter 4, that God is spirit. Those who should worship him in spirit and truth. So not position, not place, just communicating anywhere, anytime we can communicate with God.
Do you think that you are in a place like a bar? Can you also pray God in a bar?
Anywhere. Because you said any place. I say anywhere.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because God is omnipresent. Mm-hmm. That means anywhere, God is there, and God answers, God hears. Mm-hmm. God is not too far from us, you see? So we can connect with him anywhere. It's very, very important to say it again, anywhere.
Okay, now, I know that I know some people who have been praying. They pray and pray and pray, but nothing changes in their life. And I'd like to know exactly what is the impact of praying in the life of a Christian compared to someone who doesn't pray. I mean, I want you to compare a Christian who prays and a pagan.
Okay.
Because a pagan would say, why should I pray? Because this man is the way he is. Nothing changes. Mm-hmm. But what can push me to pray?
Okay. I think that we have to really define. Most of the time, people call praying the fact of going to church. The fact of going to church is not praying. Praying is a relationship built on fellowship, you see? So every day we meet with God, we cannot be the same. You see? So impacts of prayer on life of people is the impacts of God in the life of human. You see? And every time we meet with God, there's some kind of divinity that comes to us. So we have the influence of God. And when we pray, we become like God. When we pray, we have God's nature shared to us. When we pray, we think like him. Because there's something that is very interesting about praying, is that we cannot pray without the word of God. And we cannot talk to God in a language without or out of his word. Because the base or foundation of the prayer is the word of God. God is behind his word, and his word is the foundation of everything. You see? So when we go to prayer, to have an efficient prayer life, you should have an efficient reading a book, the Bible, and meditation and all the things. So that the Bible is the foundation, is the way we understand the language of God and how we can share with it.
Okay. Now, but if so, why do people pray and yet they don't receive what they ask for?
Okay. I have just a little verse here in Mark chapter 11, verse 24. And Jesus says this, the master, for this reason, I'm telling you, whatever things you ask for prayer in accordance with God's will, believe with confidence, trust that you have received them. You see, I want you to underline receive, that you have received them, and you will eat, and they will be given to you. You know, most of the time people pray, but they don't receive. They wait to see them happen. You know, it's very important to understand the receive, to accept. In other words, the Greek word means also to accept. Let me give an example. For example, when I call you and say that I'm sending you money, and I give you a code of one of the transfer money transfer and so on. When you have this code, you are happy. You didn't touch money. You didn't go there and get the money, but you are very excited. Why? Because you receive before touching it. You see? So most of people, when they pray, they just pray. After praying, they don't wait to get or receive it. You see? When you receive something in prayer, out of prayer comes thanksgiving.
Okay.
You see? And if you see somebody praying and after praying complaining, he didn't receive. And the fault is not God. We should receive. And we receive by faith.
And who's to blame? God or you, the person?
The person.
What's going to be on the basis of that? Sins or what?
Not sins. The Bible's very, very clear. Jesus said that when you ask, believe that you received. So when you may be a saint, but if you don't believe that you've already received, you will not see it happen.
So you mean that the faith plays a big role when you're praying, asking
exactly
things to God?
I told you that faith is a currency. You know, it's like money. Mm-hmm. So you can get anything through faith. Without faith in our kingdom, you cannot work.
Okay.
Yeah.
But what are the teachings from the Master Jesus to receive after praying?
Yes, of course. This is what I was just introducing. Mm-hmm. He said that receive. You see, this is the key. The key is believing that as I prayed, I know I received. You see? And when you received, you will see it happen. Sometimes it will take time. Sometimes it takes a month, 2 weeks, 3 days. But one thing is very, very true, that you will receive it. And even the way you will see the world around you will change. Why? Because you already received it. I will just tell you a little story. One day I was moneyless and my wife needed to eat something. And I said to her, oh, just talk to Papa, to Father, to Dad, to God. And she was like, she thought that I was joking. I said, no, just tell him that I need to eat really this and this and this and be specific. And after a while, I think 2 hours or 3 hours after, one of my brother came. And when he came, he said, oh, why don't you come and we are going to pay a visit to a relative. So come with us. So we get in the car and we went there. And before leaving there, the woman who received us came and said, oh, I didn't give you anything, but just take this. And when she gave, it was exactly what my wife asked.
Wow.
Yeah. You see? Because most of the time we pray, but we doubt. Mm-hmm. You see? We pray, but we doubt. I discovered something very interesting. I discovered that faith and doubts have the same power.
Really?
Yes.
Can you elaborate? Can you say more about it?
Faith is doubting that it won't come to pass. And doubt is believing that it won't come to pass. It will come to pass by faith. It won't come to pass by doubting. Uh-huh. You see? Yeah. So once you doubt, and the previous verse on Mark chapter 11, verse 23, is talking about faith. And it says that if you ask to the mountain to go, and without doubting, it will come to pass. You see, so most of the time we pray, but we doubt that it will happen, so that we don't receive it and we cancel our ask. You see, so this is where the problem is, that, you know, when you believe that it will happen, mm-hmm. no matter what, it will happen. You see, and after that, when you doubt, you cancel. You cancel your prayer, you cancel what you ask, and God cannot do anything. Mm-hmm. So most of the time, the problem is us. And Jesus is teaching us, really, to believe without doubting. We believe. You know, in Matthew chapter 7, Jesus is saying something. He says that, how wicked you are. You can give to your children good things. Mm-hmm. You see? I was talking to you before coming here. My baby boy was crying, so I should take care of him, you see? And as a father, I can understand God the Father because I would like the best for my child. So it's the same way. God will not. And most of the time, you know, we disqualify ourselves for some things. We say, we can ask this, not this. You see?
You're limiting God.
Yeah, you're limiting God. And you're limiting everything. There's a verse in a psalm where God says, ask even the extremities of the earth. So you can ask whatever you want and God will give you if you believe.
Because nothing is impossible.
Nothing is impossible with God. Yeah.
Yes, something I liked in your little story is that you said to your wife, talk to dad, talk to God, and be specific.
Specific,
that is something interesting. Isn't it that we don't receive from God because sometimes we ask many things in disorder and God doesn't know what is the priority and where to start? And
not only priority. Let me share with you another story. Okay. I had a little amount of money and I wanted to buy a car.
Okay.
And we went with some brothers and friends to search for a car and so on. But my amount was very, very little. And I wanted a specific mark of cars. So I couldn't find it. Then I went home, and after I think 2 or 3 months, I bought a car, which is, it was the same mark, and I even forgot. And one of our friends just reminded me that, oh, this is the car you wanted. I forgot. You see, why? Because most of the time, and Paul Yungisho, Pastor Reverend Paul Yungisho, is saying something in his book. Mm-hmm. He says that when you ask God, be specific. Mm-hmm. If you want a blue car, you have to ask a blue car, not yellow car, not red car. You know, most of the time when we go to God, we ask just for a car without specifying anything. You see, we should say, Father, I want a blue car. Mark, for example, Mercedes, and you know, with this and this and this, really, really specific, so that with that we can understand when, and we can even testify when God gives you, because you know who gave you.
Okay. Do you think the same formula is, or the same rule is applied when looking for a woman? You pray in God, you want to get married. You say, God, I want a woman who's like this and like that.
Exactly. I was 15 years old when I presented to God the
criteria of your wife.
Yeah.
Characteristics.
And, yes. And after a while, I even forgot. Mm-hmm. And the woman was my wife. I think that it was a time when I say to her, and she say to me, even if we remain both of us on earth, I will marry you.
Wow.
You see, it was a challenge. Mm-hmm. But after a while, she was the one with me, and I married her. And one of the thing is that after, I think, some months after my wedding, I discovered the Holy Spirit just reminded me about the criteria I presented to God. And I can see each one of these criteria in a life.
Okay.
You see? Mm-hmm. So whatever you ask, be specific.
Mm-hmm.
Because when you're specific, you will really understand and touch, you know, what you want.
Okay. Now, the last question before we close it today. Yeah. I know that we have a lot to share with you. We are so happy for that. But we'd like to know, because apart from being a prophet, you also play the guitar.
Yeah, I play guitar. I sing. Piano. And
that's so good. Now, I have a specific question for you, singers.
Okay, come
because
on.
Because people say singing is praying twice.
Yeah.
The first question is to know, is it biblical?
It's not biblical.
Okay, now the second thing is, why do singers and musicians disappear in church during preaching and prayer? They just come back when they have to play the instrument and so on.
This is my question. I think that before answering, this is my question. How did they become musicians in the church without knowing or understanding words of God?
Sometimes they become musicians, then they become Christian. They have musician first, Christian then next.
Okay, I think that we should first start by being disciples and working a church before having some, you know. I think that's, in the same time, it's a problem of musicians, but in the same time, it's a problem of pastors.
Okay.
You see, most of the time, pastors, they just want somebody to come and play music without make sure that the guy is really converted. You see? So, and the second thing is that I think sometimes also, I don't know what to say about musician because there's no reason. Mm-hmm. You see, mm-hmm. as musician, we should, even our music should have the foundation of the word, because we cannot sing without the word of God. We cannot even have inspiration without the word of God. So the word of God is very important. And I don't know why it happens, but I think that it's been a while. I saw changes in churches and so on, but I think in the same time it's musician responsibility, but in the same time it's pastor responsibility. Okay. You see? So that we should make sure that the people who are working in the church are converted, are really born again, and they know the place of the word. Mm-hmm. And some churches also, they don't have word. They have just, stories to share. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, but it's not a reason. Even there, God can speak to you,
okay,
you know, even in stories.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, now, I wanted to look straight to your camera. Mm-hmm. There is a man, there is a woman, there is a young man, mm-hmm. a young woman looking to you now who is thinking that his prayer has gone somewhere. He has mm-hmm. been waiting for the answer up to now. He doesn't receive it. But can you tell him or her something like hope okay. from the prayer? Because maybe they lose hope. Mm-hmm. They think that everything is done for them and nothing can change.
Oh, first of all, I want to say that, as I said, belief or faith is the foundation. So if you don't believe, God cannot do anything. Today, I come to you to say, just believe. If you believe, everything is possible, because nothing is impossible with God. You have to believe that God has heard your prayer, and you have to believe that you received them, and you have now acted by faith as you received them, and you will see them come to pass. So this is my suggestion to you, that you believe, and you have to believe. I have a good news for you. God answers prayer. God hears prayer. God answers prayer. And I've seen in my life, and I think that you can also see it in your life if you believe that God is powerful enough. You know, sometimes we don't receive anything because we see like our problem is much bigger than God. I come to say to you that God is bigger than your problems, and God is powerful enough to meet your needs at the point where you need a touch of God. God bless you.
Okay, thank you. So no matter how long it takes, ladies and gentlemen, one day God will answer you. Keep in touch. Keep your faith. Don't go right or left to look for something else. Focus on God. Put your faith in action, then God will answer you. Yes. That is from this word that we say goodbye to you for today, and we'll see you next time for the next episode. I believe that you are really blessed by this God servant, Prophet Schilo Franklinel. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, the English language, the language of William Shakespeare, has been risen to the place of the world's lingua franca. Now, let me define the concept of lingua franca. A lingua franca is a language spoken by different people speaking different mother tongues. For example, in Kinshasa, Lingala is the lingua franca in Kinshasa. Normally, this rise must have an impact on the way people used to consider the language of business, travel, and etc. that we call English. So, in the sake of education, Levi's talk talked to Professor Dr. Raymond SANGABAU, who is from the English department and the head of the Department of Modern Languages in the Faculty of Arts of the University of Kinshasa in the Democratic Republic of the Congo. And we discussed the topic, which is response to the rise of the English language as the world's lingua franca. Without delay, I'd like you to watch him and discover what he said about that.
Well, thank you to invite me to your platform. The answer is based on the four areas on which the English language plays its functions. The four areas has been identified by the English writer Coleman in 2011. The four functions are, first, employability. So English has been made a language for employment. And the second area of the function of the English language is mobility. So if you speak English, you can move around the world without being sorry of your knowledge of English. So you'll be happy because you will have people who can chat, can interact with you. The third area is access to technology. So English helps you to access to the information, to the new technology, what we call new technologies. And the last area is impartiality. Many conflicts are solved in English, between Japanese and Chinese, between Arabics and other people. And English has been made one of the important languages of United Nations. That is how the world has responded to the rise of English as the world lingua franca.
Now, how do countries respond to this rise?
Many countries have responded. Many countries have made English official language, even if they are not in the second circle or the first circle. For me to come back, for English countries, we have three circles. We have the inner circle, which is the countries which have English as a native language. US, UK, Australia, Canada, those countries. And out of that circle, we have the expanded circle, the English colonized countries. And then we have the outer circle, which the countries you are asking me now, those countries have made English like their official language. In Africa, you take the case of Rwanda, you take the case of Gabon. So those countries they got the point and have gone further to make English. And if you go to Asia, Malaysia, India, English has been made a language of instruction, as a medium of instructions in those kind of part of the world. So those countries, if you go to France, to Belgium, you will see that the level of the third cycle, master and PhD, they've made English like a medium of instruction. That is how the world countries are responding. And in our country, English has been made a compulsory subject in universities by a decree since 2010, by ministerial decree. That is one way to respond to the rise of English as a world lingua franca. It has been tried when the former president Kabila came. We had a lot of contact with South Africa, with Zimbabwe. So the countries which came to help Congo, and at a very high level, English was on its way to become a second official language. It is possible to have it. Because nowadays, you know that we speak about Englishes. We don't have only one variety of English. Every country has got its kind of English. We speak of Nigerian English, Cameroonese English, we have Canadian English. Why not Congolese English? We went with Dr. Bryce. I would like maybe to greet, if he can get us. We were speaking about Malewa in Goma. Oh, Raymond, we shall go to that Malewa. You see, that's kind of English with other words from our national or local languages would make what we call the Congolese English. It is possible to have our variety of English. Of course, that is cultural, and it would give a lot of advantages to Congolese people. Take the example of scholarships. The American embassy or the United States, they organize competitions for getting Fulbright scholarship and other scholarships. Once, again, I come back to Dr. Bryce, who gave me the example that among the 3,000 candidates, we scarcely have Congolese people applying for those scholarships, because we have intelligent guys, we have intelligent people here in Congo, but there is one obstacle. It's the mastery of the English language. They don't have opportunity to win those scholarships because, and when you have English education, you have a diploma for an English-speaking university, you know how it costs back to the country. So I think there would be many advantages, but culturally, there would be a fight between the French that we know. It's not a matter of fight. There should not be a fight. The languages, as far as people live together around the world, we live in peace together, but languages also should live in peace together, because we have no boundaries to communicate. We communicate with everyone around the world, not only with the French people, but we are open. And you know, Congo is a country with hospitality characteristics. Of course, many universities have opened English departments in their universities. Many universities have created ESP at the level of their countries. If you look at Brazil, you will have a sponsored project on ESP, because in that way, English is no more a language as other languages. Okay, English has become a key for the acquisition of other knowledge. So English departments have gone to their top. And within English departments, they have created ESP programs, because the ESP would look at the English program at specific programs. For example, they would look at the program for history department, they would look at English programs, the language to teach to science students, to polytechnic students, to economic students, and ESP is now getting developed more and more. That's the way. And maybe I should go directly to our university. Our universities, we teach English in many faculties. So the teachers from English department, the teachers of English department go here and there to teach the ESP classes. And at the same time, the university, they react through their English department. That's why, for instance, the English department of the university have created new orientations within the department. So would have, for example, at the University of Kinshasa, in the Faculty of Letters, English department, we'll have, for example, English for diplomacy. We'd have English for tourism. We'd have English for hostess. We'll have English for translation, for administration. That are new orientations within the English department at the University of Kinshasa. That is our way to respond to the rise. Because, first of all, we had literature and linguistics. And nowadays, it's no more adapted. So we have added other field, other orientations for research, for teaching, and for employment. Yes, I would go to my classes of English in geology. We expect students to communicate in English on their specific topics. So when I, almost half of my classes, in geology or in other is for speaking. I would ask my student to come up with a topic, discuss with the with his or her colleagues about that. That, that the outcome we are expecting is to have our student discuss on authentic material in English. That maybe would be very difficult at the very beginning, but you've seen we went with you in G3 geology. Everyone wanted to speak. They wanted to speak. But we only have 30 hours, and then we say, okay, we are stopping. The other people will give the written report. You see? So at that level, we insist more on critical thinking. We insist more on problem solving. We insist more on summarizing as skills, as study skills. So I know that we have the four traditional skills, teaching language, but at the level of university, we add additional skills. I think I will ask you to interview one student I'm supervising, Philly Ngamo. So he's trying to show the difference between learning English at a language school and studying English as a field. You know the objective of university. It is research. It is research. It is teaching. It is responding to the needs of the community. When you go to a language school, maybe you are a medical doctor, you go to a language school, you just go to acquire knowledge to communicate, or maybe to do your own research on your field, maybe. But if you come to the university, to the English department, it is to study. Maybe I should send you back to your dictionary to find the difference between learning and studying. So because when you study something, you go deep. You go deep, you go find details. You pose a problem, you find solutions. And the students who come to the English department are trained to respond to problems, to research, and to teach English. But when you go to a language school for your own needs, you go for 3 months, which is not enough to study something. You don't have courses, subject like linguistics, like psycholinguistics. You don't have courses like methodology and stuff. Yes, English department of the University of Kinshasa in the Faculty of Letters, Faculty of Arts, is open with new orientations, as I told you. We have English now for public relations. We have English for management, for leadership. We have English for secretary, for diplomacy. We have English for translation. We have English for hostess and tourism. For environment, we have English for literature and linguistics. So we have opened, and we are ourselves open to receive people who like to know more, to study all the aspects. Because people in the time, they thought that when you go to the English department, you are only going to become a teacher. But now, we have people who are interested in diplomacy, but they would have keys to diplomacy, to the language for diplomacy, for traveling agencies. So we have opened all those kind of specific branches of the English language. Last word is to thank you, Verb Pâturage, to interview us. Thank you very much. I hope that collaboration will stay between us and your TV program. I thank the bosses of your television, and I wish you all the big things and great things and a better future for your television.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
You see, if you are still sleeping, other people are already learning English through Levi's talk. Now, it is your time to learn. Let's get started. Let's now conjugate the first verb, which is the verb to be. Now, we're going to conjugate the verb to be in the simple present. But before that, watch this video so that you may discover something about the verb to be. Then I'm going to explain more.
Unit 2. A new friend.
Hello.
Hey.
Am I late?
No, you're on time. He's not here yet.
Is he French?
No, he's not French. He's Italian.
Oh, Italian. What is his name?
His name is Paolo.
Paolo is a nice name. Is he your boyfriend?
No, he's not. He's just a friend.
Are you in love?
No, I'm not.
Oh, Karen, I'm sure you are.
No, I'm not.
Yes, you are. I can see it in your eyes.
No, I'm not.
Yes, you are.
Shh, he's at the door. Hey.
Hey. How you doing?
Good.
Good to see you.
Yeah.
Okay. Affirmative form. Nous avons, à votre gauche, vous allez voir la forme normale, et à votre droite, c'est la forme contractée, ce que nous appelons contracted form or short form. I am, I'm. You are, you're. He is, he's. She is, she's. It is, it's. We are, we're. You are, you're. They are, they're. Maintenant, à la forme négative en anglais, c'est très facile. Vous prenez seulement la forme affirmative et vous ajoutez not. Donc, on dira I am not. Et à la forme contractée, on dit I'm not. You are not. You aren't. He is not. He isn't. She is not. She isn't. It is not. It isn't. We are not. We aren't. You are not. You aren't. They are not. They aren't. Maintenant, cet exercice est vraiment difficile pour vous, mais je vais vous pousser à le faire avec moi. Prononcez après moi. Isn't. Isn't. Aren't. Aren't. Maintenant, à la forme interrogative. Mesdames et messieurs, à la forme interrogative, il ne suffit que d'inverser les sujets et les verbes. Là, nous avons, par exemple, Am I happy? Are you happy? Is he happy? Is she happy? Is it a good idea? Are we happy? Are you happy? Are they happy? Maintenant, à la forme interro-négative, donc vous posez une question, mais avec une négation. On dira, Am I not Congolese, par exemple? Aren't you Congolese? Isn't he Congolese? Isn't she Congolese? Isn't it a good idea? Aren't we Congolese? Aren't you Congolese? Aren't they Congolese? Perfect practice makes perfect. So watch this conversation about contractions with the verb to be.
Unit 3. A chat in the subway.
Edward and Margaret aren't happy together.
Yes, they're quite happy.
No, Mike. Maybe he's happy, but she isn't.
But they're always together.
Yes, they're always together, but they aren't happy.
If they aren't happy, why are they always together?
Because when they aren't together, they're even more unhappy.
Oh.
Thank you. Keep practicing. Read every day. Practice every time. Because the best is yet to come. Thank you. Thank you for watching us. Goodbye and see you next time for the next episode.